From dangerous dolls to cursed paintings, here are some seriously haunting objects scientists can't explain. Number 6. Annabelle. So most of you know about the Annabelle movie and the doll's role in the Conjuring universe. But did you know the franchise is based on real people and actual events? Yes, there really is a doll called Annabelle out there, with a history science would struggle to explain. We should say the real Annabelle doesn't exactly look like something from a horror movie. The reality is more Raggedy Ann than Chucky. Nevertheless, there's a shocking history of creepy things that have happened as far as this seemingly harmless toy is concerned. It started when a student nurse named Donna received the doll as a gift from her mother, who bought the doll secondhand. Donna and her friend Angie started noticing little things about their new housemate, like the fact that Annabelle would move positions when they weren't looking, or end up on the couch instead of the bed where she was originally placed. Little notes asking for help written on strange parchment were found sometimes throughout the house too. Some of them mentioned Lou, the girl's skeptical male friend. One even said, "Help, Lou!" And one day, Lou suffered temporary claw marks on his chest when approaching Annabelle and warned Donna and Angie about her powers. There was even a time when Donna came home to find blood on the doll's hands. They found out through a medium about a little girl who died years ago in the same place Donna's apartment was built. It seemed the girl had become one with Annabelle. However, when famous ghost-hunting couple Ed and Lorraine Warren got involved, they realized the doll had actually attracted the interest of a demon. Annabelle then went to live with the Warrens, where more calamity ensued. Apparently, the doll was seen levitating on more than one occasion. Notably, a priest who came to see the doll didn't take Annabelle seriously. When he left the house, he got into a car accident and almost died. Where is Annabelle now? Locked away behind a glass case where no one can play with her. There's also a warning on the glass case saying, "Do not touch." Number 5. Basano Vase. A vase is a lovely thing to stick flowers in, right? Wrong. At least in the case of Italy's Basano Vase. Those who owned it tended to shuffle off this mortal coil pretty quick. Explain this one, science dudes. Carved from silver in the 15th century, the vase had a happy beginning as a wedding gift. However, the vow, "Till death do you part," became a little too literal on the wedding night. The bride who it was made for was found dead, lying on the floor, holding the item in question. But she apparently swore revenge. On who? The maker of the vase? The guys who made the wedding cake? It isn't clear to us, but either way, there was trouble brewing. The vase then became a family heirloom, though eventually no one wanted it in the house. Taking possession of it seemed to be a guaranteed path to an early demise. The family was so worried, they wound up putting the vase in a box and hiding it away. Unfortunately, it came to light again in the late 1980s. It was sold at an auction, and its reign of death continued. The buyer was a local pharmacist. He owned the vase up until he died mysteriously just 3 short months later. His family then quickly sold it to a surgeon who did not believe in such things as curses. He died 2 months later at age 37. A little while after that, the vase was sold yet again to an archaeologist who purchased it for his own private collection. He saw the vase as a true artifact of the High Renaissance. 3 months later, the man died of an unknown infection. The family decided to sell the fancy vase, but it started to gain a reputation and was obviously considered bad luck. This time, it took only a single month before the curse of the Basano vase took the new owner's life. By this time, everyone who knew about the vase believed in the curse, and it was then thrown out the window. As if for one last insult, the vase was reported to have nearly hit a policeman on the head, who quickly gave the man a ticket for disorderly behavior. The owner of the haunted vase said he would pay the fine, but refused to take the vase back, claiming he would rather be arrested. The cop tried to give the vase to several museums, but they all refused to take it. Probably a good idea. Apparently, the vase was buried in an undisclosed location. Though, who knows, maybe it will make an appearance again. Any thoughts on where the vase was buried? Let me know in the comments below, and don't forget to subscribe if you haven't already. Number 4. Busby Stoop Chair. Fancy taking the weight off your feet? You're probably sitting down already, but one place you definitely don't want to sit is in this bad boy, the Thomas Busby Chair. It's named after a criminal from the early 18th century who, according to legend, cursed this piece of wooden furniture after being caught for killing his father-in-law and business partner. They'd had a violent argument over their dodgy dealings, which led to him being taken to the gallows. Busby's body was then put on display near a pub and inn Busby had owned. Yeah, because that's a good idea. Tell drunk people not to sit in the chair. Eventually, the inn changed its name to the Busby Stoop Inn in honor of the dishonorable character. Naturally, people worried that Busby's spirit haunted the building. It certainly appeared to be ill-advised to sit in the chair. Those who did went on to die, though in the case of some Canadian airmen, it was probably the bombing missions they flew on more than the furniture that proved fatal. Apparently, the chair took at least 6 lives of those that sat, but there are some that claim it's closer to 60. However the sitters met their end, the air of misfortune was enough for innkeepers to ditch the chair. It ended up at the Thirst Museum in the late 1970s. And just for good measure, the chair was suspended in the air to prevent any brave souls from planting their butts on Busby's seat. Number 3. Hope Diamond. If you want to see the beautiful Hope Diamond, you'll have to go to the National Museum of Natural History, part of the Smithsonian. On the other hand, should you be a cat burglar with plans to touch as well as look, you might be in for a nasty surprise, at least according to legend, because the Hope Diamond is said to carry with it a dreadful curse. This deadly curse not only befalls the person who owns the diamond, but anyone who decides to lay a finger on it. Where does this eye-opening tale come from? Well, back in the 17th century, a man named Jean-Baptiste Tavernier was traveling in India when he saw the idol of Hindu goddess Sita. He decided to become a little light-fingered. Approaching the sacred presentation, he nabbed a big blue diamond from where it was positioned on the idol. Tavernier went and sold the rock and all seemed good in the world, until he went to Russia, where he wound up making a dog's dinner of things. Or rather, some hungry dogs made a dinner out of him. Yes, he was mauled to death by a wild pack of dogs. So far, so horrifying. Still, that's what you get when you steal from sacred cultures, right? This story was one told by Pierre Cartier, the legendary French jeweler into whose possession the diamond came. He added that a string of terrible fates awaited those who bought the sparkling sensation. Strikes me as an odd way to drum up trade, but sure got people's attention. Like any good sales pitch, however, the facts were elaborated upon. Seems Cartier was having some fun. Tavernier did indeed acquire the diamond in India, yet this happened at a market rather than thieving from an idol. Tavernier actually lived into his 80s, so the whole deal about him meeting a gruesome end from dogs certainly wasn't correct. I knew it. Good doggies. His wares attracted the interest of King Louis XIV, who wore the diamond around his neck and referred to it as the Blue Diamond of the Crown. The title of Hope Diamond is thought to come from the banking heir Henry Philip Hope, who owned the Blue Diamond in the 19th century. Was there even a curse at all? Or was it just a story, twisting violent and unfortunate historical events into a terrible revenge inflicted through Tavernier's actions? Well, one person for sure had a rough time. Evelyn Walsh McLean bit the bullet and bought the diamond. One of her sons later lost his life in a car crash. Then her daughter took her own life. As if things couldn't get any worse, her husband was deemed mentally unfit and committed to an institution. Also notable is the case of actress Mademoiselle Ladoux, who wore it while performing on stage. That ended up being a bad move. The Russian prince, Konovalsky, shot her dead. Strange, really, as it was he who had lent it to her in the first place. Number 2. Crying Boy Painting. No one likes seeing a crying child. Well, maybe some do, if a collection of mass-produced paintings is anything to go by. These eerie pieces of art appeared to be rather popular and reportedly date between the 1950s and 70s. However, it was during the 1980s that they really rose to prominence for a creepy and science-defying reason. They were pyromaniac paintings. Yes, you heard that correctly. Wherever these artworks went, fire followed. Sometimes, homeowners wouldn't know how the blazes started. One thing was for certain though, the paintings of crying children would always make it out of the flames intact. Firefighters began to realize that there was something truly weird going on. Never one for underplaying a story, UK tabloid The Sun asked the public to send in their supposedly cursed paintings. On Halloween 1985, the paper burnt all of them in a huge bonfire. It made for great press, but the burning issue still remained. So if these paintings were cursed, who was responsible? The names Giovanni Bragolin and François Civelle have been mentioned as possible artists. There was also Bruno Amadio, who apparently used the first two names as a pseudonym. One of the subjects of the artwork was a Spanish boy called Don Benio, supposedly nicknamed Diablo or Devil. Some point the finger at little Don because of his involvement in a fire which claimed the life of his parents. While the various personalities associated with the paintings are believed to be made up, the mystery still remains. It's enough to boggle the brain of any scientist. Well, actually, there is kind of an explanation, as investigations have shown. The varnish on the artwork is said to be flame resistant. Also, the prints were made on a compressed board, another material that is none too flammable. Even so, does that explain the number of fires associated with the crying children? I definitely wouldn't put them on my wall, partly because they might be cursed, but mainly because they're just plain upsetting. What about you? Have you seen one of these paintings before? Number 1. Dybbuk Cabinet. What's a dybbuk? The stories date back to the 16th century and to Jewish folklore. It's a dangerous spirit that you don't want to encounter if you can help it. One person who came across a supposed dybbuk is Jason Haxton. And where did he run into this evil force? The answer is a little surprising. He came across it on eBay, spotting a listing for what was literally called a Dybbuk Haunted Jewish Wine Cabinet Box. Haxton decided to place a bid in 2004. You can't really say he didn't know what he was getting into, though at the time, he didn't pay much heed to talk of an evil alcohol stash. Formerly owned by a Holocaust survivor, the seller was a roommate of Haxton's work colleague. Inside the box was a goblet, together with more unusual things like coins and, super strangely, locks of hair. Concerned, the seller lost some of their own hair, leading them to wanting to get rid of the spooky curio. Other craziness included an infestation of insects, plus some really odd foul smells. Haxton's plan was to pass the box onto a pal of his who worked as an illusionist. Sounds kind of mean, but okay. The results were far from magical. The gift was refused, and frankly, we're not surprised. When Haxton opened the package from eBay, he suffered from choking, skin complaints, bloodshot eyes, stomach pains, and nightmares. Not bad for $280. After consulting with scientists and rabbis, Haxton took some advice and sealed the cabinet inside another container. He then buried it and won't say where. It wasn't the end of the story for the unlucky bidder. Fate smiled on him when the box made headlines, leading him to writing his own book about the encounter. Plus, the 2012 movie, The Possession, took inspiration from the bizarre events. So if you ever see a haunted wine cabinet advertised online, best avoid it and stick with what you've got in the fridge. Thanks for watching. Are there any other haunted objects you think I left off the list? Let me know in the comments below. Be sure to subscribe, and I'll see you next time. Bye!